Macmillan Audio presents Four Ways of Thinking, A Journey into Human Complexity by David Sumpter. Read for you by Sam Woolf.
Four ways. The one thing that we just can't stop ourselves from doing is thinking. Every second of every hour, our thoughts are there, sometimes instructing us, sometimes encouraging us, sometimes telling us we can do better. They analyze what we did in the past and tell us what to do in the future. On and on they go, attempting to understand the world around us. Yet we seldom consider the ways in which we think. We don't analyze which thought processes get it right and which of them mislead us. Far too often, we fail to think about how we can best shape our thoughts. We do think about how to take care of our bodies, or at least we try to. We decide to go to the gym or go on a diet. We ask ourselves how we can be more motivated or hold the promises we make to ourselves about being healthier. We declare that we need a break from our work and talk about how we want to reduce the stress in our lives. But we seldom take the time to pause, look around, and ask ourselves whether or not the way we think about our lives makes sense. Science and mathematics are in large part about finding better ways of reasoning. It is easy to miss this point when we watch a documentary about the origins of the universe, the wonder of the natural world, or the structure of our brains and bodies. Science appears on the surface to be about facts. But it isn't. Not really. For many scientists, myself included, our primary mission is to shape our own minds in a way that gets us closer to the truth. The facts uncovered by those minds are secondary to us. This book describes four ways of thinking. Four ways of getting nearer to the truth. The origins of the four ways approach can be traced back to an article written by 24-year-old former child prodigy and distinguished theoretical physicist Stephen Wolfram in 1984. At that time, Wolfram was working on a set of esoteric mathematical models known as cellular automata. By running computer simulations of these automata on his shiny new Sun workstation, Wolfram had been able to systematically classify the types of patterns they produce. He hypothesized that every process, biological or physical, personal or social, natural or artificial, lies in one of only four classes of behavior he had observed in his computer simulations. Everything we see or do can be classified as either 1, stable, 2, periodic, 3, chaotic, or 4, complex. Stable systems are those which reach and stay at an equilibrium. Think of a domino rally. A line of dominoes stood up on end, one after another. When the first one is given a small push, they topple down and come to rest in a line on the floor. Stability. Other examples include a ball rolling down a hill to come to rest in a valley. A pestle and mortar grinding spices into a stable mix of flavors. A dog sleeping peacefully after a long walk. Periodic systems are those which exhibit repeating patterns. Walking, cycling, or riding a horse are periodic motions of, respectively, our feet, the wheel of the bike, and the horse's legs. Periodicity is the evenly spaced lines of waves arriving on a beach. It is the fast up and down motion, as a chef's knife slices the vegetables into equally sized pieces. It is our daily routines, breakfast, work, lunch, work, dinner, TV, sleep, and repeat. Chaos is our inability to predict if it will rain tomorrow or not, in the UK at least. It is the roll of a dice, the flip of a coin, the spin of the roulette wheel. It is the wild bubbling of boiling pasta water as the molecules vibrate and spin at random throughout the pan. It is chance meetings when sliding doors open or shut. Complexity can be found throughout our society. The transport of goods and services across the world, the rise and fall of civilizations, the structure of government and large multinational organizations. But it is also found nearer to home, in our relationships with friends and family, where we can feel both love and frustration at the same time. Complexity also lies inside us. It is the firing of billions of neurons in your brain. It is your personal story of how you came to be where you are today. Sometimes our actions move us between classes. Take, for example, disagreements and discussions. I have to admit that I am the sort of person who always wants to get to the bottom of everything and can be quite ruthless in my pursuit of the right answer. If I feel I don't understand an issue or someone adopts a position I don't agree with, then I'll often want to debate it further to find out where the truth lies. But my love of arguing and debating has at times caused me a few problems, not least with the people I live and work with, who, quite understandably, don't want to always spend their time going into the ins and outs of absolutely everything. So, in order to have less pointless arguments, I used Wolfram's theory to establish that there are only two worthwhile arguments: Class 1 arguments, on their way to a stable resolution, and Class 4 arguments, where important new ideas are discussed but might never be resolved. Class 2 arguments, recurrent bickering over the same contentious point, and Class 3 chaotic back and forths where we talk over each other, are to be avoided. With this classification in hand, it is easier to identify what class of argument I am involved in. Then, I think about how I might move from Class 2 to Class 1, or from Class 3 to Class 4. I can also think about how I can make my Class 1 arguments converge to stability more rapidly, just like a super-efficient pestle and mortar grinding out the truth. Notice how thinking in this way changes your perspective, away from the activities themselves and instead offering a view of them from above. Wolfram's classes allow us to think about our overall approach to a wide range of, on the surface, very different challenges. In 2002, Wolfram published his magnum opus, A New Kind of Science, where he proposed an approach to science based around his cellular automata models. The theory was extensive. The book weighs 5.6 pounds and is 1,192 pages long. And the book makes bold claims about how studying cellular automata is a path towards a deeper understanding of biological life, the physical universe, and pretty much everything else besides. But Wolfram gave few practical details about how cellular automata provide genuine insight into the real, complex world we live in. This lack of practical insight has meant that Wolfram's work has never been taken seriously by the scientific community at large, nor have his ideas made it into the public consciousness. When I searched on Wikipedia for Wolfram's work, I found a page dedicated solely to the mathematical properties of cellular automata. Wolfram's classes have remained abstract, disconnected from reality. What Wolfram didn't do, and I am going to do now, is show how his four classes can be used to shape and clarify how we think about the world. These four classes of thinking are not at all abstract. In fact, they are incredibly useful in everyday situations. My approach here is less a new kind of science, as Wolfram called it, and more a new way to convince your friends to go jogging with you. A new way of discussing contentious issues with your partner. A new way of controlling chocolate cake addiction. It is a new way of understanding why we can feel left out at parties. It is even a new way of looking at yourself as the unique, complex individual that you are. To find these new, more practical ways of thinking, I have expanded on Wolfram's classes in the four sections of this book. The way I see it, Class 1 is statistical thinking. When should you believe the numbers, and when should you be skeptical? Even more importantly, how should you interpret advice from scientific studies about eating and exercise, or about happiness and success? While data and statistics are key to understanding society as a whole, I show that they are seldom as important to you as an individual as headlines might lead us to believe. How then can we find greater fulfillment in life? This question takes us into Class 2 interactive thinking, uncovering the secrets of our social world. How can we build a constructive group dynamic? How can we change the way we communicate to resolve disagreements? I explain how to better understand the effect of our own actions on others, and how to deal with our feelings when others have treated us badly. Improving your relationships is easier than you might think. There is a catch, though. The harder we try to control our lives, the more unpredictable they become. Our failed attempts to get ourselves back on track in a world where it is impossible to know and control everything often create disorder and randomness. Class 3 chaotic thinking helps you decide when you should try to stay on top of things and when you should let go. The more complicated a problem is, the more difficult it is to solve. But what does it mean to say that something is complex? I answer this question by arguing that a system is only as complex as its shortest description. By developing an ability to summarize our social situations, our worries, and our thoughts in a concise manner, we capture their essential form. Unlike the first three classes, which are very much about solving everyday problems, Class 4, complex thinking, is more focused on introspection and self-reflection. It is about finding the stories which help us to better understand ourselves, as well as those around us. The progress through Class 1 to Class 4 takes us through the last 100 years of scientific thinking and takes us into the minds of some of the scientific heroes and anti-heroes who have shaped it. It takes us inwards into ourselves and outwards into the world we create together. It takes us from everyday mundane questions about doing housework to the deepest possible questions about what makes us who we are. And it starts now with a young PhD student embarking on a journey of discovery. Starting the journey. I step off the Greyhound bus into the hot New Mexico sun. The year is 1997, and I am 23 years old. It is my first time in the United States. Admission to the Santa Fe Institute's summer school in complex systems was highly competitive, but a reference from my PhD supervisor has secured me a place. He had himself previously participated in one of the Institute's invite-only research meetings, mixing with the big names. Santa Fe, my supervisor had told me, brings together the brightest minds in physics, economics, biology, and mathematics. Their aim? To find a unified approach to complex systems, one which would unite their respective fields and answer fundamental questions. It was to be a new kind of science. The aim of the summer school was to pass the fast accumulating knowledge on to the next generation. The participants, other PhD students and young researchers, would be housed for the next 4 weeks in the dormitories of a small liberal arts college a short distance away from the institute itself. There are lectures every morning and a chance to work on joint projects under the supervision of the institute's researchers in the afternoons. In the evenings, I would mix with students from all over the world and from a wide range of different academic backgrounds. You're going to have an amazing time, my supervisor had told me. Talk to everyone. Try to just soak it all in. It might at first appear that everyone else knows more than you, but they often know less than they let on. So don't be scared to ask silly questions. You never know what answers you might get. It takes me a while to find my way to the institute itself, and when I do finally arrive, I realize that I am late for the introduction. As I try to find a seat in the back row of the lecture theater, the scientific coordinator, Erica Jen, is already in full flow. Our aim is to teach you a different way of thinking, she tells the room full of wide-eyed students. But to get there, we are going to need to cover a lot of ground. The last 100 years has seen a massive change in how scientists approach their work. We want to make sure you know that history, but we also want to give you an approach that you can't find anywhere else. She explains how the lectures will start with the basics, how to handle data and draw reliable statistical conclusions. We will then look at interactions, how predators affect the balance within ecosystems, how neurons signal to each other within our brains, even how our human society changes over time. Then, we will learn about the role of chaos and randomness. Why is it so hard to know what is coming in the future? Finally, she says, we will look at the biggest question of them all. What is complexity? What does it mean when we say that we live?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.